Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Brothers and sisters, as we prepare to celebrate, let us call to mind our sins. We have not always worshipped God, our Creator. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
We have not always followed Christ, our Saviour. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
We have not always trusted in the Spirit, our God. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you. Pardon and deliver you from all your sins. Confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Merciful God, your Son came to save us and bore our sins on the cross. May we trust in your mercy and know your love, rejoicing in the righteousness that is ours through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Sit now for our first reading.
Verses 1 to 12. Welcome to those who are weak in faith, but not for the purpose of quarrelling over opinions. Some believe in eating everything, while the weak eat only vegetables. Those who eat must not despise those who abstain, and those who abstain must not pass judgment on those who eat, for God has welcomed them. Who are you to pass judgment on servants of another? It is before their own Lord that they stand or fall, and they will be upheld, for the Lord is able to make them stand. Some judge one day to be better than another, while others judge all days to be alike. Let all be fully convinced in their own minds. Those who observe the day, observe it in honour of the Lord. Those who eat, eat in honour of the Lord, since they give thanks to God, while those who abstain thanks to God. We do not live to ourselves. We do not die to ourselves. If we live to the Lord. If we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end Christ died and lived again, so that he might be Lord of both the dead and the living. Why do you pass judgment on your brother or sister? Or you, why do you despise your brother or sister? For we all stand before the judgment seat of God. For it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow, and every tongue shall give praise to God. So then, each of us will be accountable to God. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Peter came and said to Jesus, Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as 7 times? Jesus said to him, not 7 times, but I tell you 77 times. For this reason, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his slaves. When he began the reckoning, one who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him. And he could not pay. His Lord ordered him to be sold, together with his wife and children and all his possessions, and payment to be made. So the slave fell on his knees before him, saying, have patience with me, and I will pay you everything. And out of pity for him, the Lord of that slave released him and forgave him the debt. But that same slave, as he went out, came upon one of his fellow slaves who owed him 100 denarii, and seizing him, then his fellow slave fell down and pleaded with him, "Have patience with me, and I will pay you." But he refused. Then he went and threw him into prison until he would pay the debt. When his fellow slaves saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed, and they went and reported to their lord all that had taken place. Then the lord summoned him and said to him, "You wicked slave, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. Should you not have had mercy on your fellow slave as I had mercy on you?" And in anger, his lord handed him over to be tortured until he would pay his entire debt. So my heavenly Father will also do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother or sister from your heart. This is the Gospel of the Lord. Forgiveness, it would seem, is pretty much essential as one of the minimum requirements for anyone wanting to have a Christian approach to living. There doesn't seem to be any way around that. It might not be the only thing, but there can be absolutely no doubt that it must be up there in the top five, if not the top three. If love of God and love of neighbour are one and two, then forgiveness can't be that far behind. In the prayer that Jesus taught us, right there, it's in the middle. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. But of course, that's not the only reference we get to forgiveness. It's actually woven as a theme that runs throughout the entire Bible, and it comes to a crescendo in the Gospels. Now, the Old Testament is in many ways a catalogue of Israel getting things wrong again and again and again and again, and yet being forgiven by God, set back on the right path for them simply then to get it wrong again and repeat the cycle. In the New Testament, you only have to look at the events of the last few days of Jesus' ministry to find how central forgiveness is. At the account of the Last Supper, Jesus says that the wine becomes the blood of the new covenant. And what does it represent? It represents the forgiveness of sins. Jesus on the cross, we're told, forgives those who have crucified him because they don't know what they're doing. The criminal crucified next to Jesus is effectively pardoned when Jesus says that he will join him in paradise. Then again, after the resurrection, Jesus forgives away from him and denying him three times. And as Jesus leaves his disciples, his very last words, his last instructions to them, is that they should baptize the world. And baptism has at its heart the washing away of sins and a new beginning, with the promise that there is of daily renewal and forgiveness from then on. It is a very strong theme throughout the Gospels. When the paralytic is let down through the roof for healing, the first thing Jesus does is tell him his sins are forgiven before then going on to heal him. So important is this putting relationships right, that Jesus tells his followers that it has to come even before going to the temple with an offering to God. Therefore, he says, if you are presenting your offering at the altar and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your offering there before the altar and go. First, be reconciled to your brother and then come and present your offering. And if all of that wasn't enough of a clue as to the centrality of forgiveness, then this morning's gospel on its own would be a bit of a giveaway. There's Peter. It's always Peter, isn't it, questioning Jesus about forgiveness. Lord, he says, if another member of the church sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as 7 times. And Peter probably thought he was showing Jesus just how much he had been listening, and he understood what he was saying. After all, forgiving someone 7 times feels, well, quite generous. And number 7, at that time, represented wholeness, completeness, perfection. So it was a very good number for Peter to pick. Jesus, though, comes back at Peter, and while showing that he is, yes, on the right lines, demonstrates that he's actually way off the mark in his perception of just how important forgiveness really is in the scheme of things. Jesus says to him, not 7 times, but I tell you 77. And then to hammer the point home even further, we have that parable of the king and the 2 servants. The one being forgiven this staggering debt by the king, but then being unwilling to forgive even a tiny amount owed to him by somebody else. No doubt then, at all sorts of levels, forgiveness is a central theme of the Christian message. And the recent psychological evidence on the place of forgiveness in human well-being shows that, not surprisingly, God is right. A failure to forgive can result in festering resentment, a deep, abiding anger that can lead to physical symptoms related to stress, to anxiety, to depression. And if resentment turns to hatred or violence, it can have a devastating impact on individuals and on communities, potentially lasting for generations. Failure to forgive can indeed be a form of self-torture that is ultimately more damaging for those who are harboring grudges than for those with whom they are angry. But on the other hand, research has shown that learning to forgive improves mental and physical health. It makes people more hopeful for their future, and it leads them to grow in kindness, respect, generosity, and love towards each other. God knows how hard forgiveness is. But the evidence seems to be pretty clear that hard as it is, we need to stick with it. It is the path to the kingdom of heaven that we must tread. Now, there may be things that we can't even imagine being able to forgive, and there are definitely many things that we can see in the news that we would imagine it being impossible for anyone to forgive. Nevertheless, we are presented with the dilemma that we cannot let the possibility of forgiveness fall from the equation. God, as God himself, is perfect. Now, of course, that is a tall order. Indeed, it is impossible. We simply are not able to be perfect as God is perfect, unless God makes us so. But we need to be aware that in asking God to make us perfect, it's in the area of forgiveness and love that we will be changed. And that's where we need to be putting our effort, working with God, in our own little way, as it were. Now perhaps here when Jesus talks of God not being able to forgive us unless we forgive others, perhaps this means that God can and will make the smallest seed of forgiveness grow to perfection within us. But if that seed is not even there, then no amount of watering, no amount of tending will make anything happen at all. We are, I think, as it were, back in the same sort of place that the rich man was when he was told that he had to give all of his money to the poor, when Jesus told his followers. For it's easier, he said, for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God. And to that, the disciples quite rightly pointed out that in that case, no one had a chance. They who heard it said, then who can be saved? And Jesus said, well, the things that are impossible with people are possible with God. And that, I think, is as true of forgiveness as it is of how we use the wealth that we get. Now God knows the challenges we face, and that ultimately there will be things that we may find it impossible to forgive, at least on the human timescale. What is required is the willingness to try, an openness to ask for God's help where it is beyond us. And then once again, it is a case of the things that are impossible with people are possible with God. Amen. So would you now please stand for the Lord. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Now we sit on you.
To love and serve you. Lord, of faith and truth, church services at both churches and with a choir, and look forward to a return to normal despite more lockdown measures. We thank you and pray for the clergy team and their families, and the continued work of Hugh, Helen and Cindy. And thank you for all those who volunteer their time and talents within the life of our churches. We give thanks for all those who minister, make music and sing praises in your name. May we abide in you as you abide in us. Help us to serve you in all we do, and help us to be a blessing in this world. Lord, in your mercy. God have mercy, you hold before us a model of justice, tempered by mercy. Give courage to all who stand for justice and peace. We pray for all those who are still anxious or affected by coronavirus, personally and their families. And we pray for sound judgment, wisdom and leadership for those still dealing with COVID-19 and the new rise in numbers. Give us peace, patience and resilience in dealing with this disease. And we remember the brave healthcare professionals and social care workers still keeping us safe. We thank you for all those globally who are working on new treatments, repurposing of medicines, new vaccines and clinical trials, and pray that they will be successful. Give to all leaders and governments a wise and discerning mind. We pray for strength and courage to lead in a way that protects lives by making intelligent decisions around health, inequality, prejudice and injustice. We pray for all areas of hostility and turmoil in a world challenged to recognise how precious people are. Give vision, inspiration and hope for a better global community, to care for the vulnerable and tackle social issues to build your kingdom without walls. We pray for those who are supporting refugees and migrants, and we thank you for the work done through the Red Cross and other emergency relief organisations. May all who govern serve their people with wisdom and humility. Lord, in your mercy. God of mercy, you release us from debt we can never repay. Bless and guide all who teach and inspire the young. May we set their feet on a firm foundation for godly and fruitful lives, especially those worried about their future educational needs. We pray for children everywhere who have returned to school and their teachers, and remember those children looking forward to Sunday school returning in future. We thank you for the work with the young people of Murfield, done by the Matrix Youth Group. Help us to befriend the lonely and vulnerable, support the struggling and help us to be responsible for the safety of others. We thank you for the work and service of those locally helping to support and rebuild our local community. Be with the furloughed and unemployed and all the local businesses who are struggling, especially with the new lockdown measures. We thank you for all our blessings. Bless our homes, families and friends, wherever we communicate with people, so that peace and goodwill can find a place in the hearts of all. Send your Holy Spirit down on all new babies, new grandparents and new parents, and those who are getting married. Lord, in your mercy. God of mercy, your compassion challenges us to work for the relief of suffering. Pour out your healing presence on all struggling to cope with their illnesses. We pray for members of our congregation and friends and family who we know who are ill at this time, remembering all those on the Team Parish prayer list, families and those who are normally visited by the pastoral team or receive Holy Communion. We remember them in the quietness of our hearts and bring them to you in the confidence that you will love them and know their every need, and that your healing power is still the same today. Support them with compassion. Reassure and comfort those struggling to cope in pain and with long-term conditions, dementia, and with mental health issues. Their treatment, care and recovery at this time, and answer our prayers as you see best, remembering especially all who live in our local nursing homes and those who care for them. Stand between us and all that would hurt us. Uplift us all with faith, reassurance, purpose, hope and comfort to know your peace. Lord, in your mercy. God of mercy, whether we live or die, we are yours. Receive in your love all who have died. At this time, we pray for the soul of Toby Goldie. All those we know who have recently died and those on our team parish prayer list, and we pray for comfort for their grieving families. Uplift and comfort all those who struggle with personal grief in our congregation. Bring us to the place where sins are cancelled and we dwell in the equity of your love. Lord, in your mercy, look on this wounded world in pity and empower us to flourish for your mission, giving us your power to hold fast to the promise of peace won by your Son, Jesus Christ. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
We are the body of Christ. In the one Spirit we were all baptized into one body. Let us then pursue all that makes for peace and builds up our common life. And the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us offer one another a sign. Please.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Father, you made the world and loved your creation. You gave your Son, Jesus Christ, to be our Saviour. His dying and rising have set us free from sin and death. And so, we gladly thank you, with saints and angels praising you and singing. May be for us the body and blood of your dear Son. On the night before he died, he had supper with his friends, and taking bread, he praised you. He broke the bread, gave it to them, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." He took the cup of wine. Again he praised you, gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." So, Father, we remember all that Jesus did. In him we plead with confidence his sacrifice made once for all upon the cross. Bringing before you the bread of life and cup of salvation, we proclaim his death and resurrection until he comes in glory. Grace is the mystery of faith. Justice and mercy will be seen in all the earth. Look with favour on your people, gather us in your loving arms, and bring us with all the saints to feast at your table in heaven. Through Christ, and with Christ, and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory are yours, O loving Father, forever and ever. As our Saviour taught us, so we pray.
Now for those who are following our service at home, our prayer of spiritual communion for those who cannot be with us. Thanks be to you, Lord Jesus Christ, for all the benefits you have given me, for all the pains and insults you have borne for me. Since I cannot now receive you sacramentally, I ask you to come spiritually into my heart. O most merciful Redeemer, friend and brother, may I know you more clearly, love you more dearly, and follow you more nearly, day by day. Break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. One of the recommendations that has been made to us by the wider church is that as we come forward to receive communion in a line and socially distanced, is that we actually consume the bread as we are standing at the front rather than, as our practice had been, taking it back to our seats. So they have suggested that we simply, as we receive the bread, just remove the mask slightly and consume the bread and then move back to our places. Thank you. The body of Christ. Amen. Blood of Christ. Amen. Thank you, Lord, that you have fed us in this sacrament, united us with Christ, and given us a foretaste of the heavenly banquet prepared for all peoples. Amen. Before our final blessing and dismissal, first of all, it gives me very great pleasure to publish the banns of marriage. So I publish the banns of marriage between Rachel Georgina Armitage of the parish of St. Mark's Battersea and Nicholas Rupert Cook of the parish of Limpsfield and Tidsey, St. John's. This is for the third time of asking, and if any of you know any reason in law why these people should not marry, you are to declare it now. So we hold Rachel and Nicholas very much in our prayers. Lord, the source of all true love, we pray for this couple. Grant for them joy of heart, seriousness of mind, and reverence of spirit, that as they enter into the oneness of marriage, they may be strengthened and guided by you, through Jesus Christ. Now would you please stand for our final blessing. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace. To love and serve the Lord.